Morning.
Welcome to the house of God today. Welcome to the presence of God this morning. Amen. Amen. So good to see you all this morning. Is it good to see the rest of the church here with you?
Yeah.
All right, so do me a favor. Kind of just turn around real quick and wave at everybody. Tell them, good to see you. Happy Advent. God bless you. Every wave at the camera under the exit sign. Let the people at home know. It is a gift that we have to always be in the presence of God. Amen? But it's also a gift from God to be in the presence of the Lord's church. And so to gather with the saints of God on the day of the Lord in God's house for the worship and praise of God is a blessing for all of us. And so whether we can do that here in the sanctuary, or whether you're sitting at home doing that, it's how we are gathered together. And that is a joy that we can celebrate and something that we can do. One another. We can celebrate the goodness of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I'm going to invite you to please stand as you're able, and let's join in this morning's call to worship. Comfort, oh comfort my people, says your God. Amen. So the story is told that John Wesley's brother Charles, on the first anniversary of his sort of come to Jesus moment, was reflecting on the goodness of God, and out of that reflection wrote a song titled, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Has God done anything good for anybody here this morning?
Amen.
So as we reflect on that, maybe this song will also mean something to us as we give honor and praise to God. So let's join our hearts and voices and sing together, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Isn't God good to us?
Amen.
Would you join me in this morning's opening prayer? Merciful God, church, we are in the second Sunday of Advent. We are marching forward through the Christian year already. And we are considering not just the life of Jesus, but the message of Jesus as well. And Advent helps us do that in a very particular way. Remember, last year we started with the end of all things, and the coming of Christ and judgment, and what that means for us as we wait for that glorious day. And today we take some time to consider someone else who was a part of the life of Jesus, John the Baptist, and what his ministry teaches us, or can teach us, and what God might be speaking through his ministry to us today. But before we do that, we take time to light our Advent candles as something specific we do to observe Advent and what it teaches us. I told you last week I'm using the same reading that we used last week, and we'll use this for the next 2 weeks afterward, because I think as we go along, there'll be different parts that maybe touch our hearts at different moments. Maybe a word that sort of pierces you 1 week that maybe I don't pick up on, but maybe something else touches me, and maybe next week something else gets the person next to you. And I'm hopeful, and prayer has been that through all of this, that God would unite our concern and truly our lament for where the world is and what's happening in the world, and that God would use that as part of the revival he brings, not just to our congregation, but to the church universal. So would you join me? You can do so silently if you just want to follow along, if you want to read the words to yourself, if you want to speak those words quietly where you are, you can join it. Please do, but let's join our hearts then in an Advent lament. Oh God, if you would only tear open the heavens and come down. Come and shake us out of our apathy. Come and unite us with your compassion. Come and heal us with your presence. We have had enough of our rubble. Our rubble is not made of fragmented stones from fallen city walls and a devastated temple. Our rubble is more subtle, but just as real. It is the rubble of a world turned in upon itself. We are tired, God. We are tired of being at war with our neighbor. We are tired of tyrants who turn citizens into desperate refugees. We are tired of fearing a stranger. We are tired of the continual threat of destruction. We are tired of people misusing their positions of power against others. We are tired of acts of terror and tired of our failure to imagine any other way to respond than the creation of terror. We are tired of how our lusts and the distortion of our desires erode every relationship and destroy the lives of our children. We are tired of greed and the way it forms systems that benefit the few on the backs of the many. We are tired of our bluster, pride, our divisive political rhetoric is pushing us to the point of exhaustion. We're tired of keeping up appearances and expending all our energy for things that will not last. We're tired of the idols of amusement that sedate us into apathy. We're tired of drowning in information, starving for wisdom. With Judah, we begin a new year sitting in the rubble that our sinfulness has made, morally, emotionally, spiritually, and physically exhausted to the point of despair. We we have fallen into a gap of iniquity that seems to be swallowing all of creation in with it. Yet, you are our Father. Yet, you are the pot. We are our clay. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. Voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Amen. Sisters and brothers, this is the word of our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. As you take your seats, would you pray with me? God, thank you for your holy word that speaks to our hearts. And thank you, God, for your presence with us. now that helps us to hear these words with a new heart. Come, Holy Spirit, bless us with the full assurance, Lord, that what we hear is your strong voice speaking life. Show you a picture real quick. I don't quite know where this is, but as you can see, it snowed a little bit one day. and maybe there's a chance that maybe this picture is a little exaggerated. I don't know what it is. But just notice what's happening here. It snowed, but there is a roadway there, and there are people who need to get somewhere. You see people walking on one side of the road. You see a bus coming down the other side of the road. When I first saw this picture, besides the incredible amount of snow that's depicted, what I thought was somebody had to prepare the way. It was somebody's job to figure out how to do that. I don't know how you do that. You know, the most snow I've ever had, I think it was about a foot or so. And you know how I handled that? I went inside. But somebody had to figure out how you make a way, literally, so that everybody else can follow through. I want you to do something for me for a moment. I want you to think about your life and where you are with God right here and right now, this very. I want you to think about the experiences you've had with God. I want you to think about the ways that you have been touched by the grace of God. I want you to think about the ways worship has empowered you. I want you to think about how you've experienced the forgiveness of God. All those things that we talk about. Think about that for a moment. And I want to suggest to you that somebody had to make a way for that to happen for you. A lot of times, our young people, they don't realize there is an older saint of God somewhere. There is a grandmother. There is a grandfather. There is somebody who is on their knee praying for that young person to know the love of God. Making the way for them. And none of us have gotten to where we are today without somebody first preparing the way for us. Maybe it was a Sunday school teacher. Maybe it was a preacher. Maybe it was a parent. Maybe it was a best friend. Somebody prepared the way for you to be where you are today. Real quick, can you just thank God for those people? Amen. Thank God for those people who prayed and who taught and who trusted and who worked and who put up with us and all those things. Thank God for those people. And today we have one of those people talked about in our passage from Mark chapter 1, John the Baptist. Most of us know John the Baptist. He's the one that prepared the way for Christ. That the prophet Isaiah spoke that a sign that Messiah was here is that there would be a forerunner who would come and be preparing the way for him. Messiah. And John understood that is what he was doing. Now, we know, we can look at the small glimpse of his life and his ministry, and we can know that what he was doing was God's work, was preparing God's way for God's Messiah. We know that because John wasn't building a church. John wasn't trying to attract people to a worship service. John wasn't trying to do some of the silly things churches try to do today. As Mark tells us, what John was doing was getting people to confess their sin. Now, I wasn't there, obviously. None of us were. But just having a sense of the kind of person that John must have been, having a sense of the culture a little bit of how things work, when somebody came to confess their sin, I don't think they went and said, I have this vision of people coming to the Jordan where Jesus was, and he's teaching them to confess their sins to God. I see them saying, God, I confess. stuff too. Never realize how embarrassing that would be. Awkward. Maybe somebody next to you is like, oh, did you hear what he said? I know it. But see, if you were there, you wouldn't be thinking about that, because what John was doing for everyone there was preparing the way. And so everybody that came to him came with the same idea. I am confessing my sins to God because I know God is doing something. That's how John prepared the way, to teach people to confess their sin to God. How else can we have new life with God if we aren't willing to confess what's wrong with our old life? That's what John was able to do. And it worked. People responded. And what I want you to pay attention to, what I want you to make note of is, you know, we always kind of tease John. John's the one who eats wild locusts and honey. No sign of chocolate anywhere, right? And he dresses with camel's hair. I have a sport coat that's made from camel hair, and my kids tease me every time I put it on. You still have that camel hair with me, right? Now, to be clear, when Mark is telling us that John is wearing camel hair and he's eating locusts, he's not just telling us something weird about his diet. I think part of what's happening is Mark is telling us, you know, pay attention to who else may have done that. That's a prophet kind of thing. A prophet would be off in the wilderness speaking the word of God. He'd be that person that would look at it and think, wait a minute, that's not like everybody else. And so part of what John is doing in preparing the way for Christ to come is he is doing things the way of God. The message that he gave and what he was asking and inviting people to do was the way of God. Now that brings us, you and I, to where we are today. I've asked you to consider where you are and how God has brought people into your life that have led the way. People you probably know and can pinpoint and recognize, but probably a lot more people that you never even think of. Preparing the way. Now I want you to think about whoever is not here. I want you to think about the people who don't have a church, who have no faith or sense of identity with God. And I'm going to tell you the same thing that I think is true for that picture. It's the same thing that's true for our lives. Somebody has to prepare the way for them. Mm-hmm. The worst thing a church can think is that those people need to get their act together. You see, what John did was preach the gospel. Tell about the love of God. Tell the need to turn from your sins, to have this new life. How dare we think they didn't get their act together if we're not willing to get our act together? Somebody's got to prepare the way for the people of the world who don't know Christ to know Christ. And those people are us. That's what the church is here for. Church. That's why God made the church and gave the church power and authority to be the presence in the world that leads people who don't know God to know God. That's why we are here. And I'm sorry, we say this all the time. There's a beautiful thing about being able to come to church. See people we know and love, and I think that's part of the family of God. You know, we do things that, you know, that are memorable for us. We decorate or we do all kinds of other things. God, oh, so good. I feel good when we do that. But be careful, friends. Because when we're not careful, then we make church to be about what? When God said, my church is for the world to know. Even John the Baptist, as he goes on a little bit, he wonders, did I get this right? Am I the one? Am I doing what God's called me to do? He'll send some of his disciples to Jesus and say, hey, man, did we get this right? Because I'm in jail and things aren't going the way I thought they would. What's going on? And Jesus would respond. So even John the Baptist, as he's going through this, he's always questioning, am I doing this the right way? And the only right way we have to do anything, church, is God's way. And what God's way that we see today, John the Baptist living out, is to lead people to the understanding of the grace and love of Christ. Now, what is the grace and the love of Christ there to do? To be graceful to us, to love us, so that as we confess our sins, we are made new. Somebody has to prepare the way for the people who do not know God to know God. Somebody prepared the way for you and me. Are we going to give everything we can to prepare the way for anybody else? If that's the ministry you want, if that's the church you want to be, I want you to pray with me. Lord, we thank you because you have touched our lives in ways that we can feel and experience and look back on and give you thanks. You've blessed us with people who have loved us enough to tell us of your good news, to pray for us and walk with us in our faith. Forgive us, Lord, if we ever make your church anything else. Forgive us when we prioritize the things that are important to us over that which is important to you. But free us now to recognize that we all have need to turn to you. And for those who don't know that need, you're calling us to prepare the way for them. Give us your strength. And give us your grace. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks be. So church, we are going to share in the sacrament of Holy Communion. So I invite you to open your hearts, take a moment to pray. We obviously aren't taking communion the way that we used to. Obviously, everybody's not here like they usually are, but we are still able to gather. And as long as we can gather, we can share in the sacrament that is a gift from God, something that reminds us of God's willingness to prepare the way to touch our hearts. So, if you would respond in this morning's communion liturgy, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right because even though we sit at the tail end of what has been such a difficult year for every single person we know, and so many more, there is still much to be thankful for.
Amen.
There are still ways that God is moving, and there are still ways that we have been blessed by the hand of God. And so, Lord, we give you thanks, and with your whole people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name. And we join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of our mind, heaven and earth, hold your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
On the night in which Jesus would give himself up for all of us, he made sure that each of his disciples, that group that he walked with for those years, he made sure that every single one of them was there around the table with him. We aren't able to do that right now like we usually are. We can't make sure people are here. There's people watching with us, thanks be to God, and there are a few of us here. We're grateful. But let's be mindful that it was that important to Jesus to make sure that each of those 12 would be there, even especially Judas. Preparations were made, and things were set in place so that what Jesus did would not just be something that they experienced, but be something that you and I are able to live into as well. And that if somebody is missing from this table, it becomes a priority for us to go and find them. Because Jesus told us he came to seek the lost. And that night when he was with his disciples, as they celebrated the goodness of God, as they thought about all the ways that God had saved them and their people, they praised God. I think with song and prayer and thanksgiving. In the middle of that celebration, Jesus took a piece of bread and he gave thanks to God for it. He blessed it and he gave it to each one of his disciples. Each one of his disciples. Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. I'm not quite sure how much time passed, but when they did a little more celebration, maybe there was some other liturgy that they shared, maybe they sang another song. But after that supper was over, Jesus took a cup of wine, gave thanks to God for it, blessed it, and made sure that every single one of those disciples. Every one of them took the cup and said, take, drink. This is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And now, all these years later, somebody made the way for you and I to share in that same meal. So, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and as a living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ is God, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And Lord, we bless you for your presence, for your healing, your salvation. As you bring your Holy Spirit to us once again, God, prepare us to take this meal with joy and thanksgiving, but also with the knowledge that you are asking us to prepare a way for someone else to sit at the table with us. Bless us, God, with your peace. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. In church, we'll take just a few moments to share in prayer. If there's something you want to lift up to God as a way of prayer, you just stand where you are if you want to, or call out the name or situation. We'd love to lift that up to God now. What are we praying for, church?
My friend Sylvia Adame, her son is in his late 30s and he's in the hospital. His name is Aaron Gabriel Adame and he's got pancreatitis and he's got some kind of a mass going on there. So Tuesday he'll have surgery and as she told me, it can be minor, it can be major. So she's just asking for prayers.
Lord, hear us. Let's join together in praying the Lord's Prayer as our Lord has taught us, shall we?
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
gathered in the presence of God, as we take the bread and the cup, we remember the body of Christ given for us and the blood of Christ poured out for us. And as all of us share, as many as we are, we share from the same cup, the same table. Aren't we made one with God and with each other? No. So I'm going to ask Gloria, didn't you have me somebody else too? Oh, wait, hey, hey, hey. Here in the sanctuary, we're going to share the communion elements. If you're at home and you got beer, have that prepared. But don't open it quite yet. We want to do all this together as much as we can. Friends, if you'll go ahead and open up that piece of bread there. Remember, a little piece of wafer. When we receive it with worship and thanksgiving, it means something to us. Reminder, goodness of God. It's the way that we experience the grace of God. Sisters and brothers, go ahead and remove your mask, please, and quickly let me declare to you that this is the body of our Lord, broken for you. And, before you open up the juice, turn the cup over. Lord, thanksgiving. Receive the blood of our Lord. Poured out. before we finish our time together, gather and worship, a couple things I want to tell you real quick. We do have our offering box back there if you want to leave your offering. You usually do, but it's check cash, whatever you do, and we take care of that today. And, or you can give online, wearekelsey.info. That's an easy way to stay connected to everything that we are doing together. But also there's another box back there. This box will be held by someone we all know and love. Mary will be back there, and this is the box that we're using for our angel tree. She's collecting donations for that. We have an end to be a blessing to some local students. At which school? I'm sorry, Mary, remind me.
It's going to Cobb Wilson. Unfortunately, I guess we were a little late in getting into Crockett, and they had already, by the grace of God, they had already filled all the students. Mm-hmm. And so Megan has a personal friend who is the assistant principal at Cobb Wilson, and she said that they had several needy children in their school. So we're trying to collect money, donations, and then a few of us will go and purchase whatever it is that is recommended to them. Some of these kids are even living out of their car. So we are all blessed, and hopefully we can bless them.
Amen. And thank you, Mary, for you and Megan taking this on. It doesn't look the way we usually do it, right? There's no pretty tree out with the names and everything, but what else has been different this year, right? But we still have a way to be a blessing, so if you want to do that, you can get with Mary after worship. There's a line in our online giving. If you want to designate any gifts to that, you can do that online as well. But thank you, church, for your consideration of being a blessing to the world. As we finish our time, I'm going to ask you to please stand. I'm going to offer you a benediction as our way of asking for God's blessing as we leave this place to go prepare the way for others to know God. I want you to know that you are all a blessing to me, and I give thanks to God for each of you. I pray for you. And it's part of my prayer that when we come together as a church, that all of us feel loved by God and one another, and that we also feel called by God and one another as well. So until we can be together again, whether it's online or whether it's here on Sunday morning, receive this benediction. May the God of all grace, God of all wonder, fill you now, his joy, reminding you the way that you have come, reminding you of the way that we are to live and go. Go down that way and in God's peace. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Thanks be to God. God be with you, church.
Awesome.
Yes, I am. I'm still supporting them.